Good evening, and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know. You can find us on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. I'm Gloria Duffy, President and CEO of the club, and tonight's moderator. This program is sponsored and supported by the club's Inforum division. That's our element of the club for younger members. And it's my pleasure to introduce today's distinguished guest, Gavin Newsom, mayor of the city of San Francisco and candidate for lieutenant governor of California. Gavin Newsom, a Democrat, was elected mayor of San Francisco in 2003. He was the city's youngest mayor in 100 years, and he is still just a kid at 42 years of age, at least compared to me.
Yeah.
Mr. Newsom graduated from Redwood High School in Larkspur in 1985, yeah. In 1989 from Santa Clara University with a BA in poli-sci.
Surprise.
His Plump Jack wine shop, founded in 1992, grew into a multi-million dollar enterprise, now including bars, restaurants, and a Tahoe hotel. He was first appointed by self-same Mayor Willie Brown to serve on San Francisco's Parking and Traffic Commission in 1996.
Yeah. Miss it.
The start to a fabulous political career, and he was appointed the following year as a San Francisco supervisor. Mayor Newsom has had a number of priorities during his two terms as mayor, including cutting bureaucracy, something that he experienced when he was a business owner in the city, job creation, combating homelessness, a particular focus, development projects in Hunters Point and Treasure Island, establishing universal health care in San Francisco, something in which, under his leadership, San Francisco has now led the nation to a similar concept, and marriage equality. In April 2009, Mayor Newsom announced his intention to run in the 2010 California gubernatorial election. In October of 2009, he withdrew his candidacy for governor, announcing his candidacy for lieutenant governor. He was recently endorsed by Senator Dianne Feinstein, a big one. He is married to Jennifer Siebel and is the father of a seven-month-old daughter by the name of Montana. Please welcome Mayor Gavin Newsom.
Thanks. Thank you. If I had known I was running for lieutenant governor, perhaps I'd have named her California. But I wasn't thinking that strategically at the time.
That'll come in handy on the national political scene.
I know. I got a nice letter from the governor of Montana. We framed it, Governor Schweitzer. Talk about a character. My gosh.
Why don't you tell us, well, might as well start out there. Why Montana? Why did you name her Montana?
We got married in Montana. My wife has a family home out in Montana, and she grew up there. And it's just hard not to love, any of you who visited Montana, not to love Montana. And I've now become obsessed, and I'll admit this, with fly fishing. And there's simply no greater place anywhere in the world to fly fish than in Montana. So we thought it was appropriate to celebrate a life and a narrative, our daughters, by celebrating a place we hold dear and a place we love. And I think, you know, it's a different name. My name was different. I think it makes me a little different when you have a name like Gavin. You know, Kevin, you know, the guy from the Love Boat, Maxwell, you know, people sort of make fun of you over the years. And I think it's good. It's a little differentiation.
So how are you as a fly fisherman?
I'm terrible. But in Montana, I'm brilliant because there's so many fish. But false sense of security. We have, by the way, in San Francisco, I didn't know this. This is a huge cult. This fly fishing stuff, it's sort of an underground thing. But in San Francisco, we have one of the great fly fishing casting clubs in the world, truly in the world, up in Golden Gate Park. One of those wonderful little gems you discover in Golden Gate Park, which I, by the way, have rediscovered as a resident now of Haight and Masonic, or at least a few blocks away from Haight and Masonic. And so I do not monthly walks in Golden Gate Park. There's certainly multiple times a week and every weekend, and I've rediscovered truly the greatest urban park in any big city in this country. Eat your heart out, Central Park in New York. It really is that spectacular. For all of its challenges, for all the things that we recognize need to be improved in Golden Gate Park, there's so many magical places to rediscover, and I can't impress upon all of you more to do just that. I know I would have said, oh, I know the park well, except I really didn't until I started getting back into the neighborhood in more frequency. And Stowe Lake, an obvious place to start, and the Rose Gardens, and going around. I mean, what a gift, isn't it, to tell friends and family or to go yourself to the new Academy of Sciences, to go across the street to the De Young Museum, to go down to the Conservatory of Flowers, to be able to go to the Japanese Tea Garden and remind yourself of what it was like as a kid to experience that. Or important to me because my grandfather, Arthur Menzies, has a garden within the Strybing Arboretum, and to rediscover the Strybing Arboretum. I mean, it's just magnificent. All of this within walking distance. Again, a quick afternoon in Golden Gate Park, and that's just a small portion of this spectacular park that I think all of us should be very proud of.
Well, we are going to get on to some serious topics now, and we'll get
good.
Back.
That is a serious one.
We can talk
one.
About
parks
fishing for cutthroat trout in Montana later. But starting close to home here, you know, I was pretty shocked to hear Mayor Villaraigosa's announcement yesterday that city offices, except for vital services like fire and police, are going to be closed 2 days a week in Los Angeles due to budget pressures. How is San Francisco's fiscal situation? Are you looking at any resemblance of that situation
LA? Interesting point, and let's frame this question. Antonio Villaraigosa, the mayor down in Los Angeles, actually manages a budget not completely dissimilar to the budget in San Francisco. And you say, well, how is that possible? LA's exponentially larger city. It is, but they're not a county. San Francisco is the only city county in the state of California. This is incredibly important because it also goes to one of the great critiques that we receive, and I receive as mayor all the time, and it's, why do we spend so much money? Why do we have so many employees? With a city our size, this makes no sense. And the reason is fundamentally, and I can get into subtext and argue point by point where we do too much and where I argue we do too little, is because we're a city and a county. We manage the water system for the region, the Public Utilities Commission. We manage the airport. We manage redevelopment agencies. We do the work that only other counties do in welfare and health care. These are things that the mayor of LA does not focus on because it's not within his portfolio. But that portfolio includes roughly a $7 billion budget. He has a huge shortfall. He announced 1,000 layoffs, and then a few months later announced an additional 3,000 layoffs, 4,000 layoffs. He's talking about increases in utility bills. Imagine if I did this, of anywhere from 9% to 26%. City Council rejected that increase, came out and supported a smaller increase, as a consequence exacerbated his budget shortfall, and as a consequence of that, just yesterday announced, to the surprise of many, including me, that he is shutting down city services, not on furlough Fridays once or twice a month, but 2 days every week, effective next week, for all non-revenue generating departments and for all non-public safety departments to address the underlying fiscal challenge that he faces in every city, large and small, not in the state of California, but roughly speaking, across the United States faces. We are addressing a $522.2 million shortfall on about a $6.6 billion budget. Of that $6.6 billion, only about $1.2 billion is truly discretionary. So the reality is that $522 million shortfall is against not a $6.6 billion corpus, but a $1.2 billion discretionary budget. That's a huge number. We, unlike the president, and unlike the governor and the legislature, we cannot borrow and spend, and we cannot tax and spend, and certainly, unlike Congress and the president, we can't print money and spend it. We have to balance budgets constitutionally. Our charter requires a balanced budget submitted to the Board of Supervisors, our county board, by June 1st of this year. Again, without taxing and without borrowing. Now you say, well, wait a second, you can tax. Well, we can only ask you to tax yourself. And you won't be afforded that opportunity until November of this year. I have to submit a balanced budget by June of this year. And I don't know if you will approve a tax increase, because many of you, I imagine, think we're playing plenty in taxes. So this is a big challenge. The answer to your question, no, we will not be shutting down city departments 2 days a week. No, we will not be laying off 3,000 to 4,000 people. And yes, we have a lot of work ahead of us and a lot of other sacrifices that need to be made. But I also find this an exhilarating time because it allows us to think differently about the way we deliver services. It allows us to organize ourselves in ways that the political frame would never have allowed us to organize. And I think a lot of good things will happen. And I know that at peril, I get quoted as being out of touch for saying what I just said. So please, those of you that wish to do that, create the context to which I've offered those comments. A lot of tough decisions, a lot of sacrifices, but at the end of the day, some good things, I promise you, will occur. Quick point of reference. Last year, $436 million budget shortfall. Sky was falling in, world was coming to an end. I announced that it wasn't a crisis, and the member of the Board of Supervisors, the chair of the Finance Committee, said I lived in a parallel universe. People said people will die because of the budget. They said these cuts would devastate the social service infrastructure of the city. What's remarkable to me is a year has gone by, and we had the highest on-time performance in our public transit system in history, the lowest crime rates in over half a century. We were able to reach milestones we never could have imagined in terms of public support for our parks and recreation system, the highest scores ever, the best scores ever in clean streets, as dirty as those streets are. We had the highest surveyed responses to clean streets. We paved more streets last year than any time in the last 20 years. Still in terrible condition. My point of saying this is we found ways of working through that in a way where the impact wasn't as draconian as some profess and promise and as sometimes the media leads you to believe. It doesn't mean there weren't sacrifices and choices and decisions that had an impact. They were, but we will work through this, I am confident. This one's a huge challenge, but this is my seventh budget. I've only had challenging budgets, and I feel very confident we'll get through this.
So could you capsulize your strategy for getting through it? So what are the guiding principles as you go into these difficult budget challenges?
Well, you try to avoid things that cost you money, meaning a lot of times, this is what frustrates me a lot about what's going on in the state of California. And again, and not a critique, I happen to personally really like and admire the governor. I mean that. And he's a good person. And he does care. And he's trying to do the right thing. I think he's made some mistakes. I know I have, too. And such is the nature of political life. Some of the mistakes he's made is he's made cuts in areas that actually end up costing us more than they save. So a fundamental guiding principle is why cut something that will end up costing you more than the actual savings that you can make? Why cut things that will not allow you to leverage money? Why do things that are difficult to unravel if you make that cut that it will take years and years to catch up? These are sort of the framework to which we analyze the budget and make decisions. I'm not going to back off on my commitment to universal health care. We're the only city in the United States of America that does it, regardless of pre-existing conditions, regardless of your ability to pay. You don't have to wait till 2014 to begin to see the implementation of federal health care reform that, after it's implemented, still will not provide access for at least 20 million people. In San Francisco, we have comprehensive, universal access today. And I'm proud of that. And I don't want to see that unraveled. And by the way, our plan becomes more important. There are 8 million people in the state of California without health care, millions that are not here with documentation, that whether you believe that's a good thing or bad thing, they end up in your county hospitals in an acute care environment that costs you a lot more than it would if you stabilize people and invested in their health as opposed to waited to treat their sickness. In San Francisco, our healthcare plan makes that commitment. We've reduced costs. It's a public plan, a public option. The American flag is still flying in front of City Hall. It has not been replaced with the Canadian flag. Kaiser, the largest HMO in the state of California, has joined our public plan. And we have 3 independent studies verifying and validating my assertions. And this becomes, for me, a predicate and a framework for a big part of the reason that I wanted to run for governor, and I want to be part of the fate and future of the state as lieutenant governor, because there are 57 other counties that don't do this. And there'll still be at least 4 million people in California, I estimate. Again, the numbers keep going up. They don't go down. The next 4 years, they're not going to necessarily go down. They're going to go up. So you can imagine where we'll be in this country. And then when you start the implementation, there'll still be millions of Californians that will not have health care, even after the federal reforms are implemented. What are we going to do about that? What are we going to do to stabilize a budget where already Medi-Cal, which is Medicaid in California, is consuming about 15% of our discretionary general fund? It will be over 21% in the next few years. What are we doing to slow down that rate of growth in terms of those costs? Those are the things that I'm consumed by. Those are the things I care about. Those are the things I will fight for in this budget. I will not unravel and undo the work we've done to get 11,000 people off the streets, 10,835 people off the streets since I've been mayor. I'm not going to give up on my commitment to continue to advance supportive housing, which is the ultimate solution to homelessness. Shelters are not. Shelters solve sleep. Housing solves homelessness. But housing with underlying supportive services to deal with issues that all of us are familiar with in this room become then critical to ultimately turning people's lives. I don't want to unravel that. There'll still be cuts to programs related to homelessness and substance abuse and mental health, but I don't unravel that fundamental framework. So I can go on and on, department by department. That's the thinking and the deliberative process to which we then analyze every dollar we spend in city government.
I think a useful way to take this conversation is to look at what you've done in San Francisco and then look at the lieutenant governor's job and look at how you would approach that and what this background does for you in approaching that job. So let's dwell for a few more minutes on your accomplishments in San Francisco, the areas you've really carved out here as the basis for going on and looking at the challenges of the lieutenant governor's job. What do you see as your key accomplishments in San Francisco?
I'm not going to get nostalgic yet. I'm still in my seventh year. And look, I think we've reduced the street population by 40% in this city. We went 30 years going in this direction. Now we're moving in that direction. But I drove from City Hall to here. I saw exactly what you see every day. I get it. I mean, don't think for a second I don't. Just give you one statistic. You'll appreciate this. Last survey we did in January, this is a remarkable fact, that 44% of all of those folks out on the streets of San Francisco have been there less than 90 days. We have a return to residency program. This is not Greyhound therapy. We don't just throw people on a bus and they disappear. It's a very different type of program. We've returned people to every single state in this nation outside of Alaska, Hawaii. Vast majority, Washington State and New York and Texas. Interesting. We're not just dealing with a San Francisco problem. If we had those 11,000 or so folks, we'd have pretty much solved the problem in our city. We're dealing with a national problem manifested in the state and notably regionally. I was talking to some folks outside. Our panhandling problem is not a homeless problem. It's a panhandling problem. It's a behavior problem. It's a poverty problem. 156 people, 75 locations, the most chronic panhandlers, two-thirds are not homeless. And the majority are not from San Francisco. Every one of these issues needs to be tackled and dealt with differently and uniquely. We've expanded our homeless outreach. We've expanded our supportive housing. We've expanded our drop in capacity. We've expanded our transitional strategies. And we've expanded our behavioral health and substance abuse related strategies, methadone maintenance in particular. I want to keep doing those. Those are things I'm very proud of. Those are things that I believe are accomplishments, not for me, but for the people that we're trying to serve. And it's testament to the lives that have changed. You know, 3,033, this is an exact number as of today, because we had the courage to move in a different direction years ago, away from a cash-based system of care to a service-enriched system of care not cash. You think gay marriage was controversial? They were burning my body literally in effigy in San Francisco. I had never had more security in my life than my inaugural for mayor in 2004, because all the death threats associated with my work on homelessness as a supervisor. 82% decline in the caseload. 3,033 people will testify today that their lives are dramatically better because we had the courage to do something different than what the folks at City Hall told us we should be doing. I'm proud of that. I'm proud of the work we did today, finally breaking ground in Hunter's Point, at Hunter's View, West Point and Middle Point, in Bayview Hunter's Point, Hope SF. This is the biggest public housing investment of any city ever in the history of this country. And I don't think this, I know this, and I've studied this. We're doing it ourselves because the federal government has failed to address the issue of concentrated poverty. With all due respect to the good work we did with the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act over the last four decades, give me a break. Give me a break. Tell that to the folks in Bayview Hunter's Point, where asthma rates, cervical cancer rates, prostate cancer rates are 2 to 4 times the state and federal average. To the folks living at West Point and Middle Point. So we finally broke ground to revitalize this area, cobbled together money over 4 or 5 years. And we've got 8 other sites. There are 8 total, 7 other sites, public housing that we're going to start rolling out in the next few years, a local Hope 6 to revitalize our old public housing sites. I am proud of that. I'm proud of the fact we're the only big county in the state of California with universal preschool. I'm proud of the fact we do comprehensive arts education for every single person in our public schools. Every child, every classroom, K through 12. City fully funds arts education. You probably didn't know that. I'm proud of the fact we have the highest performing urban school district in the state of California. You certainly didn't know that. I said urban. It's a lower bar. But progress is being made. We believe that you want to get serious about public education in the state. All of these things are things I want to do as lieutenant governor. When was the last governor, let alone lieutenant governor, even brought up the word homeless, even used it in a sentence? I don't mean that as a critique. It's just you don't get elected saying, you know, if you wonder how to get elected, look at what Meg Whitman is putting on TV. Because there's not a word she uses that hasn't been focus grouped and poll tested. I joked with my campaign team. They said, we need to do polls. I said, why? Just look at Meg's website. It's jobs, reform, and education. That's what you're thinking. I promise you, and most of you probably are. But it doesn't mean that's what you should limit your focus. And she says, I know one thing, corporate world, you've got to limit your focus. I don't believe in that. See, we did universal health care and universal preschool. We got 11,000 people off the street, and we repaved more streets than any time in city's history. We're doing long-term aging facility, Laguna Honda Hospital, and we're redoing our acute care facility, San Francisco General Hospital. We're rebuilding public housing, and we put together the greatest anti-poverty program of any big city with Bank on San Francisco, payday loan strategies, highest minimum wage, paid sick leave ordinances. We are the envy of a lot of other cities. We did all those things. Thank God we didn't limit ourselves to just 3 things. Our unemployment rate is high, but it's the 5th lowest of the 58 counties in the state of California. Still too high. We're doing a lot of good things. We're addressing our unfunded health care liabilities. Tell me a city is doing that. We're dealing with pension reform. Yes, San Francisco. You have the chance, June ballot, to vote to begin to substantively address pension. What city is doing that? We balanced our budget without any general tax increases last year and the year before. Our bond rating went up last year as California's dropped below Louisiana. It was reaffirmed a few weeks ago. LA's, by the way, dropped again today. I'm not suggesting ours won't drop because of the magnitude of the macroeconomic problems, but we remarkably, you wouldn't believe this if you read the paper, are doing fairly well. We have a 10-year capital plan. First time in history we actually have a capital plan. We have fully funded it every year. 167 parks and playgrounds have been completely revitalized in the last 6 years. That is something I'm very proud of. You know, in spite of all the consternation and critique at the board of supervisors back and forth, we work together remarkably well. And I'm really proud of that as a fundamental thing as well.
Here, here. So, a wonderful record of accomplishment in San Francisco.
And we've talked about a lot of problems. You want me to give you that list, too?
Budget and finance, homelessness, education, and so on. Now, let's talk about the role of the lieutenant governor.
I see you were setting me up.
Well, no, not setting you up, but logic suggests we look at what you've done here, and then what the lieutenant governor does, and how you would approach that job. Now, the lieutenant governor's job seems to change somewhat, depending on who's governor and how they split up the responsibilities. One thing we should talk about is the strange system we have in California, which is that the lieutenant governor and the governor run on separate tickets, and you can have them of two different parties. And what if Meg Whitman is elected, and how do you work with her? So that's one question. But
loving.
But the other question is, currently, the lieutenant governor does the following things.
Yes.
Sits on the UC and State College Boards of Regents, chairs the Commission for Economic Development of the State of California.
How many of you honestly knew that?
Sits on the Ocean Protection Council and the State Lands Commission.
Two of you heard about that.
And also on the California Emergency Council that deals with emergency preparedness.
That's a big one.
So those are key things that the lieutenant governor does. Which
and chair
are,
of state lands, yeah.
Yes.
Social protection, yeah.
So
and those
talk,
are not insignificant.
Right,
I mean, let's talk
about,
those are three areas that we care about, right? But let's talk about that, because that's education, higher education. Is there a more important topic than that, from my humble perspective?
Let's talk about higher education, then.
Let's do that, and then environment. You care about offshore oil drilling, you sure as heck care who your next lieutenant governor is. And if you care about, well, economic development and workforce training, maybe this office actually has some gravitas. Maybe it can do something meaningful and purposeful. And maybe because it hasn't, I always say the past doesn't equal the future. It doesn't necessarily mean it can't. So let's talk about those things. Higher education, I just left Bob Corrigan. He was in my office with the superintendent of schools. Bob Corrigan's head of San Francisco State University. We were just with the Haas Foundation, you name the foundation, we had them all in my office. And we were asking for support because, I don't know if you know this, San Francisco guarantees a four-year college education for every single sixth grader in our public schools.
Now, how does it, what do you mean it guarantees?
It guarantees. We gave certificates of guarantee to all our sixth graders last year, guaranteeing them.
Really?
Access to a four-year college education, the support to get there, and the financial aid if they need it.
That means state college,
San Francisco
college, city college.
This is a partnership through California State University, mm-hmm. through the city and county of San Francisco, and through the school district called San Francisco Promise. And you don't give out certificates of guarantee lightly to sixth graders.
Well,
and we did that. Now, why does that matter? Because it goes... Yeah. To your specific question of what would you do for higher education as lieutenant governor.
I should say that has been the policy of the state of California for the last 50 years, since the master plan on
right.
higher education. So that's kind of bringing down to the city level what the state has guaranteed every
Oh, they don't. I mean, they don't
student,
deliver.
But we can't do
yeah,
that
Yeah, they don't
now
deliver. But
for budgetary reasons.
And that's exactly why we're doing what we're doing, because we're going to deliver. And
okay.
we're making that guarantee. And we have formed a public-public partnership. I don't know about you, but... I created 1,300+ jobs, 17 small businesses. I'm a business person. I believe we can be more businesslike. With all due respect to Meg, I don't think you're going to solve the problems in the state by cutting waste and duplication, streamlining regulation, and creating 2 million jobs by 2000 whatever. I just think that's just a lot of rhetoric. That being said, I also believe that public-private partnerships are not the only solution to every problem. That public-public partnerships should be a bigger part of the narrative of reform. And what I mean by public-public partnerships is engaging other public institutions to build capacity, particularly at a time of limited resources. And that's what we're doing with the California State University system, with our public school system and the city. We have this framework. We're advancing this framework. I'll give you just a really remarkable fact. Last year, every single student in our public schools took the PSAT. You remember the old PSAT?
Mm-hmm.
You probably, 9 out of 10 of you don't even realize when you took it, someone paid for it. Your parents paid for it. My mom must have paid for it. I didn't know that. All these kids, they don't take it in public schools. They don't take it, even in our own school, no one can afford it. Last year, everybody did, during the school year, during the school day, and we saw a 40% spike in 40% spike in 1 year in the applications to San Francisco State University. I mean, this bar is so damn low that I want to underscore, it didn't cost us a fortune. This is about using common sense and being strategic in terms of your investments. These are things that I want to do as lieutenant governor. Build partnerships, build capacity. You have 478 cities in the state. You have 58 counties. You have 69 cities with populations north of 100,000. Who's the advocate for those cities, large and small, in those counties? Who's building capacity and partnerships with over 1,000 school districts up and down the state? What's happening with dropouts when 140,000 people a year are dropping out? What are we doing to stem the dropout rate? There's a stat, 8 out of 10 prisoners are dropouts, the California penal system. I mean, you want a corollary. You want to connect some dots. So the issue of higher education is fundamental, not just CSU, but UC, and don't ever forget the 109 community colleges up and down the state. And you need a strong advocate, and I look forward to being that strong advocate.
So with Bob Corrigan and the foundations, what you were working on, I expect, was getting private philanthropy to come in and support that commitment to every sixth grader that they will be able to attend
college? To supplement our commitments. The city made a commitment. The school district made a commitment. The CSU Board of Trustees made a commitment. Now we want to have a more sustainable commitment coming from the private sector. And by the way, Speaker Pelosi, through, I know we're not supposed to call them earmarks, through congressionally directed investment into our city, made a commitment to this pathway of a four-year college because of the resonance it has received nationally, not just in this state. Look, I don't want to get too fixated on this because it's hardly the solution to higher education and the need to reconcile the remarkable budget cuts that we're experiencing. But it is to make a point that the solutions to the problems of higher education, the solutions to prisons, the solutions to health system and homelessness, with all due respect, aren't going to be found up in Sacramento. And they're going to be found at the county level. They're going to be found at the city level. Cities and counties are laboratories of innovation. States are laboratories of democracy. We need to unleash our cities and counties. And who has been an advocate for cities and counties in the Lieutenant Governor's office? 99.9% of these folks come from statewide positions into those. They don't come from county or local government and come in with that advocacy and that perspective to build capacity, not rhetorically, but substantively from the bottom up.
So I think that's an interesting model that could be scaled up and applied to other cities, and that is an interesting approach to the statewide problems with funding of higher education. To get mobilize, I expect, corporate and private philanthropy in communities to support public school students' access to four-year higher education.
So is an oil severance tax that would go directly to higher education, which I've supported for a long time.
Let's hear about that.
Well, there you have it. You just did.
What is an oil severance tax?
Well, I mean, California is the only big state in the United States that doesn't have an oil severance tax. You recall, it was a prop, I think, 87, a number of years ago, Steve Bing put $40+ million of his own personal wealth because they couldn't pass it through the legislature to put this on the ballot, and you had the oil companies spend more money than Bill Clinton and Al Gore spent on their presidential campaign in 1992 to defeat it. And we are the only, we could generate $1.2 to $1.5 billion, some would argue it's closer to $2 billion a year at a 12.5% oil severance tax. And with all due respect to my friends at Chevron, ExxonMobil, hadn't been like they've been, you know, in dire straits the last number of years. And again, every other state in this nation, including up there in Alaska, has oil severance taxes, but California doesn't because they bought the legislature. I said it. You were thinking it. Let me underscore this point, and this is important. In 2007, there were 52 bills through the California Democratic-controlled legislature. 52 bills that the oil companies didn't like. Guess how many passed the Democratic legislature? 3. 2 were vetoed by the governor, 1 passed. There are 8 lobbyists for every legislature in the state of California. Over a 2-year period, and you can look at the decade-long period, but over a 2-year period, the last 2 years, going back 4 months, the last 2 years, $553 million was spent defeating or supporting bills. There were 2,900 that were introduced last year, 625 that the governor signed. My point is saying the big challenge in the state is the dominance of special interest money. Now, special interest runs every stripe. There's special interest I know a lot of you would support in this room for higher education funding, for environmental advocacy and stewardship. But these are the kind of things where we need real leadership, and we need someone to use the bully pulpit, and we need someone to galvanize people around some solutions. It's not going to be easy. These are tough, tough things. And so that's just another example of helping people say, well, more substantively, what are you going to do? I offer that as an example. Let me give you one more, because why just end there? And I'm not a tax and spend liberal. I'm not profligate in my ways. I try not to be. Again, I told you I didn't raise taxes, general taxes, to balance budgets since I've been mayor. But in this environment, why is it the last time we raised our tobacco tax was 1998? It's 87 cents. We're 32nd in this nation in terms of tobacco taxes. Rhode Island was at $3.46 the last time I looked at it. You can increase the tobacco tax by $1.50, get it up to $2.37, and generate another $1.5 to $2 billion.
So the so-called
these are many ideas to substantively fund higher education.
Sin taxes are your one of your
well, I don't
purchase.
Know. The oil companies wouldn't call oil a sin, but
gambling, tobacco,
yeah,
et cetera.
Well, gambling I didn't bring up, but that's
okay.
Another.
So let's move on for a second, and I think that was a very interesting insight into approaches to higher education funding that you would bring at the state level. Now let's talk about economic development. So as Lieutenant Governor, you'd be chair of the State Economic Development Commission. And its roles include trying to foster economic growth, developing and implementing strategies for attracting new business to the state, increasing state exports, creating new jobs, stimulating industries statewide. So what do you bring from your thoughts and your experience in San Francisco to
Gosh,
that at the state level?
Can't wait. Are you kidding? Look, when I became mayor, we didn't have an economic development office. I created the mayor's office of economic and then made it economic and workforce development. First thing we need to do in the state is completely realign and reimagine and reform our workforce development system. It needs to be streamlined. You cannot have an economic development strategy, from my perspective, without a workforce development strategy. We have a very specific plan in San Francisco that we've executed over the last 5 years. We have focused on biotech and life science. That's why we went from 2 biotech companies when I was mayor to 56 today. That's why we got the California Stem Cell. Bill Rutter, your guest coming up,
right.
And you're celebrating,
right.
Was a big part of getting the California Stem Cell Institute to locate in the city. Because of those efforts, working in partnership with community colleges, Bridge Du Biotech program, to create workforce training opportunities for people, particularly in the southeast sector of San Francisco, that have been locked out of those opportunities. Digital media and digital arts, strong focus and discipline there. And then a focus on green tech. 197 green tech companies in San Francisco, tax incentives to get green tech companies to come to this city, workforce training programs, green academies that we've organized to connect those dots, open an office, foreign trade, we did in San Francisco to China, because the state, where arguably one out of three jobs is somehow connected to international trade, you can make that argument, has decided to get out of that business of proactive engagement. We got in. And what a godsend it has been for San Francisco. We open up an office in Shanghai, San Francisco, your city, open an office, a foreign office. And we've recruited companies like SunTech, Yingli Solar, and others. Largest photovoltaic manufacturer in the United States, or the world, excuse me, is located, their North American headquarters here because of that initiative. Those are the kinds of things that we need to be doing. Extend to aerospace, don't give up on it. Certainly extend to agriculture, $36 to $39 billion industry in this state. And to a few other strategic areas. That's exactly what the next lieutenant governor should be doing as chair of that Economic Development Commission, and that's what I intend to do.
Would you be traveling abroad a lot, do you think, leading delegations? Or?
Yeah, it always sounds, trust me, more glamorous than it is. But
that wasn't meant as a...
No, I know. Some of you, though, probably, oh, yeah, there it goes, the
no,
travel.
It's important work.
it is. I mean, look, I think the greatest opportunity is China. For California, it's a gateway. We're gateway to Asia and Pacific. I've always believed that. It's why San Francisco has gone so far out of its way to cultivate that support from China. And whether you want to dismiss China because you don't like China on human rights and you've got strong opinions about Myanmar and you have strong opinions about Tibet, fair enough. But you got to deal with the economic realities and the opportunity to build bridges and to create real job opportunities and economic growth, and specifically in terms of green tech, I think this is a huge advantage, strategic advantage for California, and we should be front and center. And that would be a big part of focus. Also in India, and we need to focus more on India. We just established a regional sister city of sorts, because it's San Francisco Bay Area with the Bangalore region and the state of Karnataka. We just did this a few months ago. This is a big opportunity as well to build those ties. So those will be the two areas, in addition, obviously, to the primary trading partners, which are Mexico, which are Canada and Japan, for the state that we would build on, again, if I have this opportunity.
So let's talk about the lieutenant governor's role in relation to the governor. What if Meg Whitman is elected governor?
I don't think she'll think much of the job of lieutenant governor.
How would you work? What would you expect, and how would you work with her?
Well, look, I mean, everybody. So at the end of the day, you've got those five or six commissions. And by the way, the emergency, this is a big deal. I don't think this. You know this. All of us know this. God forbid, any hour, any day, any week, month, year, this region, this state's going to be rocked with another significant earthquake, and we need to prepare. San Francisco updated all our emergency operations plans, convened our disaster council after 8 years. We've really organized. We have the first regional emergency operations plan, first one in the United States. We, San Francisco, organized. This is a great opportunity for San Francisco to take its know-how to that discipline and focus and regionalism and partnerships. But the rest of the job is really the bully pulpit. It's what you make of it. It's your capacity to be creative and not accept the condition that limits your authority, but to make decisions that can change that condition and make a difference. You want to be supportive where you can, Republican governor or Democratic governor. You want to be part of a process of reform, and I believe in not wrecking this state government. I believe in reforming it, and I'm concerned you've got one candidate that potentially could wreck it in terms of the direction she's promoting. Now, I don't know if she's sincere about that. Maybe it's just politics. You can't get rid of 40,000 state employees when you only have 200,000 unless you're going to devastate the Veterans Administration. I mean, go up in Yountville. I'll just give you an example. You guys, I don't know if you know this. We have 1,000 veterans in Yountville. That's a state-run agency. How are they not impacted if you're going to lay off 40,000 state workers, if you're not going to touch the prisons and do everything else? I mean, the math just doesn't add up. So she's either lying to you or believes we're just dumb enough not to do the math on these things. That concerns me. That really does. And I think a lieutenant governor needs to be there, if she's in there, to be a strong voice, say, oh, wait a second. Hold on here. Let's have an honest discussion. We need to reduce the size of our bureaucracy. I get that. We can't afford what we have. We understand that. We need to reduce waste and duplication. Let's do that. Let's reform our civil service system. We've done it here. But let's do it in the right way. You cannot do things to people. You have to do things with people. I promise you this. If someone comes in, as Governor Schwarzenegger discovered, and says this is the way it's going to be, they will get nothing done. The interest groups are so entrenched up there, nothing will happen. You cannot do things too. You want to reform education? Even if you don't like the California Teachers Association, you need to work with them and to build partnership and trust. And we can do that. But it needs a governor and a lieutenant governor, the extent that governor is willing to have a lieutenant governor helping them to, I think, make real progress. So if former Mayor Brown, because we were mayors together, if Jerry Brown is our next governor, I look forward to being a strong partner in areas where he can't focus. You know, they'd say, hey, you take the homeless issue, take the health care issue, take the environmental issues in terms of work you've done on solar and green buildings. And I'll tell you, not a city in America has done more on environmental stewardship than San Francisco. And it's not just composting requirements and high recycling rates and going after plastic bags and plastic water bottles. I mean, we have done things that really I don't think most folks know. We just did yesterday the largest municipal solar project in the state of California, arguably the country, 24,000 solar panels out on the Sunset Reservoir. This is a big deal. We did it in this economic environment. We have a per capita generation on solar that's higher than any other county in the state of California. San Francisco converted our taxi cab fleet over 57% to alternative fuels. Remember Mayor Bloomberg promised that on the Today Show? They haven't delivered. We have. We did it before he started. Biodiesel, grease cycle, that's why you have frying pans on the side of all the buses, because we're converting fats, oils, and grease from restaurants and dumping them into our muni buses. These are exciting things. And a governor, lieutenant governor, can really spearhead those work up and down the state of California and build on the promise of AB 32, which I'm a fierce supporter of, and I'm concerned that Meg Whitman is a fierce opponent of.
Reminding our radio, television, and internet audiences, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California's radio and TV internet broadcast. We're speaking tonight with Gavin Newsom, mayor of San Francisco.
I think most, you know, and some of you in this room, I'm sure, are here because you can't stand me and you wanted to be reminded why. And others may actually think I'm not so bad, and others may just might be convinced, but I don't think anyone would disagree that I'm unwilling to be bold. And I'm unwilling to take risks. I think most every one of you would agree with that. I have no desire to be lieutenant governor. I want to do the job that a lieutenant governor should do. I don't want to sit around, nor do I sit around as mayor, and just wait for things to happen. I want to get involved. I get involved. And I want to make a difference that transcends the limitations of the moment. I mean, same-sex marriage is a good example of that. I think we had an impact. Again, whether you supported it or opposed to it, we had an impact on the debate. We're having an impact on the healthcare debate. We've had an impact on the environmental debate in this country. We're having an impact, I don't think this, I know this because the conference calls I have, on the homeless debate. I know it doesn't, again, feel like it all the time when you walk our streets, but we are. We're having an impact on the education debate in this state. So I want to get up there and have an impact, and I'll be creative. And yes, I'll try to reinvent it. Every candidate for lieutenant governor will tell you that, and everyone that served, you know, said the same thing. But I really believe that I can offer that. And maybe that's my entrepreneurial side, again, that guy who opened all those small businesses, that I just feel that there's a creative energy that I want to explore with that office to challenge what people believe that office should represent.
What about reform of state government? A lot of people think it's broken, and you know, we now have the new Citizens Commission on redistricting. We have the proposal for a constitutional convention. In fact, somebody in the audience would like to know, do you support the idea of a state constitutional convention? Would you participate in a reform agenda to try to improve governance in the state of California? Oh,
understatement. Look, I've been out front on the constitutional convention. I think I was the first sitting elected official, certainly mayor in the state, that supported it almost 2 years ago, went up and down the state and supporting it. I mean, you guys, I think, know this. The Constitution in the state of California is the second largest in the world. I mean, it's ridiculous. And it's been amended on how many hundreds of occasions, and the U.S. Constitution only a few dozen occasions. I mean, it's long overdue. Look, I believe we need to do what we've done in San Francisco, two-year budgets, more robust rainy day reserve, so we can deal with this boom-bust cycle in terms of capturing revenue. I believe that we need to do aggressive realignment, meaning realigning state dollars to empower cities and counties that are on the front lines of service delivery. This is something, again, uniquely I think I can offer in terms of perspective. I believe you've got to get rid of the two-thirds requirement to get a budget passed. I just, you know, to the extent that you say, no, 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 it works so well, please show me the evidence. I mean, I really am sort of fed up with the argument against not giving it a try. I mean, and people say, well, you know, okay, Rhode Island has the two-thirds. Well, we're not Rhode Island. Arkansas, by the way, those are the only two other states that require two-thirds. Every other state seems to manage quite decently. And once, almost everyone would argue much better with a simple majority. That we certainly should do. Those are just a few examples of things that are long overdue that I think need to happen in this state. But again, if we can do it in San Francisco, we have a robust rainy day reserve. We have those. We have a two-year budget, as I said. We do five-year financial plans, 10-year capital plans. We have a pay-as-you-go policy. Did you know that in San Francisco? We have one, pay-as-you-go. We do that. I believe if San Francisco can do this, if we can start attacking unfunded health care liability and address pension, if this city can do it, I'm absolutely confident California can do it with all of our unique interest groups. So don't buy the pessimism. I get so depressed out there, and I know how challenging things are, and I'm not naive to that, but I'd rather be California than any state in this nation, one of the most diverse states, and we have more Nobel laureates, more scientists, more engineers, three of the top six universities in the planet, more IT, more venture capital. We're the birthplace of life science and biotech. I mean, this state is the envy the rest of the world. It's time to start acting like it again, not looking naively at what's wrong, but building on what's right. I've always believed you're nothing but a mirror of your consistent thoughts. You tend to manifest what you focus on. If all we're going to focus on is what's wrong, that's exactly what we'll get. But if we start building on what's right, it's limitless, our possibility. If you want to deal with education, start focusing on 140,000 dropouts. We can get our arms around that. Start focusing on special needs education. We can start making inroads on that. Start focusing on prison reform by saying we're going to reform parole and we're going to reform probation and reentry strategies. And we're going to invest in more workforce training in the prisons to reduce our recidivism, like prison industries. We can do that. We can get serious about green tech by making investments and creating tax incentives and creating zones of opportunity and start building workforce development to be the envy of the world in terms of green technology and build on that leadership that exists today. Look, there's so many things that are absolutely doable. And that's how I think we start turning the corner. And then, again, get back to the place that I think all of us know where we belong as Californians. I really believe that. There's a spirit here. And a value proposition that's critical to preserve, protect, and advance.
So you and I had a little bit of discussion beforehand about how one runs for lieutenant governor. And I think that relates to a question from the audience. How can you manage our city fiscal and other challenges while you run for lieutenant governor? But it's a little bit of a different type of a race than one might imagine. You're not running all over the state.
Yeah, I'm not looking down the barrel of a $150 million campaign by my opponent. It's one nice thing about running for lieutenant governor, not governor, as Governor Brown is now looking at. You know, we're at $59 million of personal money, an additional 10 raised and spent, or about to be spent, $69 million, and we haven't even wound up. I mean, look what Meg Whitman's doing to Steve Poizner, and she's 40 to 50 points ahead. I mean, if she was 10 points ahead, I'd say stop wasting your money, and she's 40 to 50, and she's just getting going. Can imagine what she'll bring out in the next few months. And the question is, you know, and I think she's very, I like Meg. I don't think she should be easily dismissed. I don't know that I trust what she's promoting. I don't know if that's what she believes. I'm kind of hopeful she doesn't. Because, you know, most people that I talk to that know her don't believe some of this, but they just know that's the politics of getting where she wants to go. I'm just hopeful. But I am nervous about the money, and the question is, well, how do you run for lieutenant governor? It's very different. Look, I did 26 town halls. I was in 2/3 the counties. I was out there in Fresno. We were out there in Placer County, these red counties doing town halls. We were engaged and had 2-hour dialogues like this and got on every issue. That was wonderful, but now I can't do that. So I'm focused on making my case by getting on TV, or getting off TV up here, on TV elsewhere. I think you've had enough of me up here. But in Southern California, I'll be making a case of what we've done and what we want to do, not just talking about yesterday, but tomorrow. I'm running a positive campaign. My opponent is a different point of view.
Now, your opponent is Janice Hahn. Is that who you're thinking opponent will be?
Yeah, she's the opponent. And so we're running a positive campaign, focusing on issues and ideas. And so I'm going to, you know, I do that. The good thing, look, if you're going to be mayor and you're going to survive being mayor even for a month, it's the old idea that it's the tyranny of or versus the genius of and, that you got to be able to do this and that as opposed to this or that. The point being that, you know, this morning we had a protest and discussion about child abuse, and then we had a child care discussion, and then we had a discussion about health. And you know, you go topic to topic, issue to issue. I had 4 people shot today in Viz Valley, so I went out to the scene. That changed the day. Went back, did labor negotiations, spent afternoon on budgets, then higher education late this afternoon. And you know, in between that, I took an hour, made some calls, got big endorsement today. I'll announce tomorrow. And so that's kind of how I'm doing it. And I'm trying to be everywhere at once. And so no one misses me and no one knows, you know, that I'm not focusing on this or that, but they think I'm focused. And I'm trying to do everything and be responsible. And I wouldn't have run if I didn't think I would, if I couldn't be responsible to you and my obligation to be an effective mayor. especially at this time. I simply would not have done it. That's why I spent 2 months really deliberating this. And I really feel the first 3 weeks I've been in that I've really given it my all in this city and given it my all on this campaign. And I've worked my tail off in both. And you learn quickly, Gloria, I think you can appreciate this and everyone out here, when you have a child, everything you used to complain about now is put in perspective, particularly sleep. So it's actually a glorious thing waking up at 5:03 every morning. And I need to wake up then to get all this done.
Sure. So Janice Hahn, a member of a Southern California political dynasty, related to Kenneth Hahn, I assume?
Yeah.
Member of the LA City Council.
Wonderful family. Brother was mayor, father was a legend, did extraordinary things. I like her. She's a good person. She's running a lousy campaign in terms of just being, you know, she's running one, I guess you have to when you're down a little bit. It's unfortunate. It doesn't elevate. But, you know, I get it. I can't really hold it against her, even though at times I want to. Because it's gotten a little nasty. I mean, just gratuitous shots, you know, which are just so unnecessary and don't help the party. But I really do wish her well, and I think she's a good person. And but I think, honestly, and I may be dead wrong, but I really believe, you have to believe this, so I hope it doesn't come across wrong, I think I would do a better job. So that's it.
You talked about the oil companies. But
someone from Exxon here or something?
On the positive side, are you comfortable with the level of corporate citizenship or corporate social responsibility in San Francisco? Which are San Francisco's good corporate citizens?
Oh, well, I like that question. Salesforce.com, extraordinary. You know, by the way, the reason I have specific numbers on homeless counts is because of them. They provided it pro bono.
That's right.
Real data is being collected. We do something called Project Homeless Connect, which I'll tell you is one of the things I as well am most proud of. It's been replicated in 221 cities, 29,000, over 29,000, I can't remember, 29,000 something. Unduplicated people have been served since we started this. Over 17,000 volunteers, unique unduplicated volunteers have engaged. It's really amazing. Salesforce has done great things. Levi's is legendary. Gap does more than most people would expect. You know, we were with a couple people that are helping you today, Deloitte. You know, Deloitte has given a tremendous amount of human capital to a lot of our efforts in grassroots. Schwab, Carrie Pomeran Schwab, she's done great things, and things, again, below the radar that you wouldn't even know for the city. You know, Don Fisher, with Bill Rutter and others, really are the reason we have the Stem Cell Institute, because they had to write the checks. You know, Don wrote millions of dollars in checks. We're redoing athletic fields in the city because of Bob Fisher and John Fisher. And folks don't know that. They put up $20 million and are raising another 20. That's $40 million. Just that family to revitalize fields. Garfield Park out there out at Crocker Amazon they did. Hamilton, across from Hamilton, they're doing the fields. They've done some great things. So a lot of wonderful people out there doing good things. The answer, though, to the question, is there enough? Not even close. Not even close. And it's a big pet peeve of mine. That and I think where the reason why is we beat the heck out of these guys up every single week at the board. And we lay them out. And I won't tell you who, one of the biggest philanthropists in the city said he wanted to donate a big piece of public art, and he said, I won't do it. I said, why? He goes, because I don't need the controversy, I don't need the headaches, because I know that someone's going to oppose it. And so it's going to New York. And it's just indicative that some folks just don't want to get into the political stuff that happens at City Hall.
Talk about looking a gift horse in the mouth.
Literally, in this case. I mean, we're very lucky that Fisher has left his collection to the San Francisco MoMA. We're very lucky. I mean, even if you were opposed, you know, to the Presidio, we are lucky. I mean, there were members of the Board of Supervisors that spent every week attacking Don Fisher personally, not just the company, The Gap. It's remarkable that he committed himself and his family still to the city. They love the city. Don may have been a Republican. Well, my wife's family's Republican. You know, it doesn't inherently make you bad. Quite the contrary. quite the contrary. I mean, but sometimes in San Francisco, we kind of act like that. You know, I'm offended. You know, come on. This is a city of inclusion. It should be, and we should wrap ourselves around everybody. I mean, at our best, it's our capacity to live together and advance together across our differences, to celebrate all those interesting differences, but unite around the things that bind us together. And that's the best of San Francisco's values, and I think we should pay a little more attention to that down at City Hall.
I gather from a question you met with President Obama.
Yeah, a number of times.
What did you talk to him about the question. Recent time.
Well, I'm the head of the U.S. Conference of Mayors Task Force on healthcare reform, so I've been out front on the healthcare debate. I didn't necessarily get what we wanted, but I tried on the public plan, public option, and give them evidence. You know, we were not talking anecdotally. We were going to show them evidence. We have a Kaiser Family Foundation report, UC Berkeley jobs study, reports that came out about our plan to show the cost effectiveness and make the case. But we spent a lot of time working on that, a lot of time on, right now, the issue of poverty eradication. I mentioned Bank on San Francisco. This is amazing. Roughly half of African Americans and half of Latinos in this city do not have access to a checking or a savings account. You want to get serious about poverty eradication and people are living a paycheck, paycheck. Do you know that there are more check cashing places in this country than McDonald's and Starbucks combined?
Yesterday at the Commonwealth Club, our speaker was John Hope Bryant, who's a real evangelist for banking the unbanked and so on.
John's a great friend of mine, and
terrific guy.
We spent a lot of time together. He and Chuck Schwab are partners of the Presidential Council on financial literacy. So we have now 48,000 people that have opened up free savings and checking accounts, and now we're going after payday lenders. Oh, let me tell you, 450%. Interest rates. This is serious stuff. This is all those payday places. I mean, how the heck you ever get out from under? We are going after them. We call it Payday Plus, first city in the country to do this. And this is why I'm in trouble in any general election, because, I mean, this is, you know, I know this is serious business for folks because it's a lot of money at stake. But these are the kind of things that we need to be doing and fighting for, and these are things we should be proud of, and things that that we'll be talking a lot about.
Well, we are reaching the witching hour, and this has been a great, wide-ranging discussion.
I hope.
I will ask you one more question from the audience, which actually came in several different forms. You mentioned those 5:03 morning wake-ups now. How has fatherhood changed how you see government and your role as a leader and politician?
Oh, gosh. I mean, it's a softball. Look, you know, I told my wife this, and I guess I could tell all you. Everything else is an open book in my life. I said, when I had my baby, I said, I always knew I wanted a child, but I never knew why until I had a baby. And then I learned the why, and that's the most important thing in life, is the why you're doing whatever it is you're doing. It's just the greatest gift. And all of you know this, that have had kids. And it becomes that rote cliche, doesn't it? That you see your performance in the eyes of your child, your effectiveness and your capacity. And you see that now in the eyes of other kids. I have a completely different, profound appreciation for parents, particularly, and I will end with this, and I mean this, women. And I'm not saying this, you're thinking, well, this is, I grew up, my mom, single mother, 2.5 to 3 jobs all her life. God is my witness. We were a foster family when I was growing up. She was 19 when she had me, 20 when she had my sister. My father, they got divorced right after that. And she raised us, and she did it all on her own. And I lost her years ago. She was a survivor of breast cancer, and then she became a victim of breast cancer. And it's my only great regret at life so far. I've had plenty of other regrets, but not at this profound, that I never fully appreciated who she was and what she did, and everyone else in that same position. How many millions of people in that same position doing extraordinary things? She never complained. And how many other people are out there doing that every single day? And so that's what's changed me. It's given me a depth of appreciation, not here, but here. No longer my head, but my heart. And that, I think, can only make me a better person, which is most important. And if you're a better person, you can be, I think, better in whatever profession and advocacy that you support and are engaged in. So I hope it makes me a better elected official as well. Thank you all very much.
Our thanks to Gavin Newsom, Mayor of San Francisco and candidate for Lieutenant Governor of California.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And thank you to our audience here in San Francisco and audiences on the radio, television, and the internet. This program, in association with the Inforum Division of the Commonwealth Club, is now adjourned. I'm Gloria Duffy, and thank you for joining us this evening at the Commonwealth Club.
Thanks, Gloria.